Stacey Kent is an American jazz singer whose career highlights include a Grammy nomination, album sales in excess of 2 million, gold, double gold, and platinum selling albums that have regularly reached number one in the charts, and acclaimed concert appearances in more than 50 countries. With her warm, lyrical voice and poetic interpretation of standards, Stacey Kent is the epitome of jazz sophistication.
These commuters here, you said, could be.
Welcome to Beijing.
Oh, thank you. So happy to be here.
Welcome to Blue Note. And this is where you're going to perform tonight.
We are going to perform here tonight. We were here last night.
Last night, too.
And we get tonight two shows. It's very special. I mean, really very special and very meaningful. And I even said to the audience last night during the show, you know, I'm looking at them because I'm singing to them. But then when it's not my turn and I'm standing to the side and I turn around and I see Blue Note Beijing, you know, I know I'm far from home in this place where I'm meeting people for the first time, and it's a very powerful feeling.
First time here.
First time here.
In Beijing.
In Beijing.
Not first time in China.
No. We played in Xi'an last year, and then we were in Shanghai, and we've been in the neighborhood, but we've not come here yet, and so finally we've made it.
You travel extensively.
We do. We do. One of the reasons that works so well is because I'm always with my husband, Jim Tomlinson, who is quite simply my best friend.
You don't have to argue with the family, say you have
no,
to
that's
be
right.
traveling
well,
for work, huh?
This is the thing. I don't have to say, bye, honey, see you in 3 months. So this is where he stands.
Yeah.
He's on saxophones and flutes and percussion.
Okay.
He writes a lot of the music. He writes all the arrangements, and he produces my albums, and we tour together, which means that when I'm on the road for a long time, as much as I love what I do, if I left home for 3 months and left my family, you know, I'd be quite sad. I'd be quite lonely. As much as I love the guys, you know, to have my best friend there who gets it. We get each other, you know. We have jet lag at the same time. We're getting on and off of the plane at the same time. We have the same experience. We have the same musical experience. So to share that is really important, and that's what allows us to tour as much as we do.
Yeah, it's a blessing to have a husband who does basically the same thing. You know, you're on the same job, and also he's so multi-talented, which means you save a lot of budget.
Jim and I, we grew up and grew into this together. When I met Jim, I was a comparative literature student. He was a philosophy, politics, and economics student at Oxford. We met, we both decided to go on a one-year course in music, and then boom. But we didn't make the decision. When you're on the course, what happens is, it's a post-grad course for students. And so people like British Telecom or the Natural History Museum, they call up the college and they say, we need some students to come and play for this event.
Oh, wow.
And we started to get these calls. So this kept falling in our laps. You know, I feel like this is the point in my life that made me a fatalist, because I didn't mean to be on this path, but everything kept pushing me on this path. So it was a decision made for me because word of mouth kept spreading about me. Oh, go get this girl. She's good at this. If I had stayed in New York, my parents were very, nothing against my parents, they were lovely, but they were very involved in what I was doing and kind of controlling over my path, you know. If I had been there, I probably wouldn't have had the guts to have said to them,
boom.
Yeah, that's right, that's right. And then when the course ended, and I was supposed to go home. This is the part of the story that I don't tell that many people that often, but I like this part of the story. We got married. We got married in secret. Because my parents
had secret. You didn't tell your parents.
No, because my parents hadn't met him yet. We knew we were going to spend the rest of our lives together, so it wasn't something impetuous. But I was going to be kicked out of Great Britain at the time.
I guess maybe one of the reasons was your parents were not quite sure that they would agree to your decision to do music?
Yeah, yeah.
They never saw that in you, or what?
They did, but, you know, knowing my parents and their situation, you know, they were first generation immigrants into America.
Okay.
They grew up with nothing, and they made something.
They want stability.
It is the same, when I talk to my friends in America whose parents emigrated from India or from here or from Italy or from other parts of the world, we're all in the same boat. So that second generation has pressure. And I invited my parents to the premiere in New York. They went, hey.
This is happening.
This is okay. She's going to be okay. So they were okay eventually.
Yeah.
Walk right across the desert.
A New York native, the London-based Kent did not initially want a career in jazz music, graduating instead with a degree in comparative literature. While studying at London Guildhall School of Music and Drama in the 1990s, she took up jazz singing. Working alongside her husband, saxophonist Jim Tomlinson, she began receiving a number of accolades, including two BBC Jazz Awards and a Grammy nomination for her 2007 album Breakfast on the Morning Tram. As evidence of her strong international following and in recognition of the fact that she often sings in French, Kent was awarded the Ordre de l'Art et de Lettres by the French Minister of Culture in 2009. She attributes her love for the French language to her grandfather, who emigrated to America from France.
I mean, I guess everything that happened in your life would, in the end, contribute to what you're doing today.
Yeah.
Comparative literature or all these different languages that you learn, I'm sure they all have a role to play in your career now. So, but what kind of connections do you see between, you know, what you learn and what you do now?
I think that my path led me here because, one, because I was that literature student, and language student, and I think that gave me such a love of storytelling, and it taught me early on that I was able to tell my story in my way. But maybe even more important than that, my grandfather grew up in France, and he grew up with nothing, but he still loved his own, he loved his own trajectory, he loved his own story in the world. Until when he went to America and he fell in love with a woman and he settled down, he really didn't like being in America at all. He never felt right there.
He's French.
He was. But we totally connected. And he gave me so much. When he was sad and he taught me French and we would speak in this language and he would have me recite poetry and I was good at it. You know, I could repeat after him and, you know, I got it quickly. I saw him change from this sad man to this joyous man, just for those minutes.
That actually feature is the feature that many people noticed about you singing your time on the stage, that it's so honest and so straightforward that just like you're using your voice as the instrument, as your music, to tell the story.
Yeah.
Probably it's like, you know, when you studied your literature.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly that. I think that, you know, there are different ways to be on stage. We know this. And this is what's wonderful. You know, some stage shows are big, and they're loud, and they're noisy, and they're visually very noisy as well, right? You know, if you go to Las Vegas and you go to a show, you're feeling something that is artificial. But I don't want to use artificial in the wrong sense, because we love that. You know, we all like lights and lights, camera, action, and all that fun. It's exciting, and you see it all over the world. You know, I'm thinking about the, you know, Bollywood films or what goes on all over the world. We like that colorful craziness. Technicolor movies with Judy Garland, you know, they're not real, but you enter into this very big, colorful world. But then there's the other kind. You know, I grew up listening to people like James Taylor or Cat Stevens or Crosby, Stills, Nash or Joni Mitchell or João Gilberto. One person on a stage, maybe, with just a guitar. It's very honest, it's very intimate and personal.
And engaging.
And really engaging. So you couldn't have one without the other. But what you have to do as the artist is find which voice works for you best. And for me, I wasn't one to dress up in, you know, feathers and boas. I keep using my hands to kind of gesture. That's not who I am. Mine is much more of a quiet, but still, I hope, engaging way of taking you and me on that very intense but quiet journey.
Was it because, you know, you found it more connected to sing your own original songs or what?
I think that I grew up in the standards and I love the standards and I still sing the standards. And in fact, they have more potency to them now because I'm not singing them all the time. Every time I grab one and I put it in the set, it feels really powerful because it's just there in and of itself. But I think I felt an itch, I mean a real itch. So we're coming to the point where Jim and I met Kazuo Ishiguro.
So here you are in the city with a shattered heart.
Among the lyricists who have contributed to Stacey Kent's repertoire are her husband, Jim Tomlinson, and most notably, Nobel Prize-winning author Kazuo Ishiguro. Constant themes throughout her sounds are memory, travel, and love. Originally noted as a singer of the Great American Songbook, Kent has developed her own highly distinctive and personal repertoire. Her most recent albums have featured original sounds composed by Tomlinson with lyrics in English, French, and Portuguese.
For what the citizens hear.
Ishiguro was a fan of our music. He played me on the radio one day in the BBC. And
you're both fans, right?
Yeah. That's how I found out that he was a fan of mine, because I heard him talking about me on the radio. And I was completely overwhelmed because I loved Ishiguro's world. I mean, talk about understanding somebody's vision of the world. You know how there's some writers who you read, they might be a great writer, but you don't necessarily connect. And some writers, you read them and you see their vision.
You don't get that many Nobel laureate to write a song for you.
No. I mean, it's incredible to sit here and talk to you and tell you that story. That's a real pinch me kind of moment. How did that even happen? That serendipity, that timing, that I found out that Ishiguro was this writer who liked my music. So I wrote to him through the BBC.
You didn't know each other before?
Never met. And I said, "Dear Mr. Ishiguro, I heard your Desert Island Discs talking about my music, that you would take one of my songs away with you for the rest of your life on a desert island if you were stuck on a desert island. I cannot tell you how much this means to me because I am an enormous fan of your work." So anyway, long story short, we got in touch with each other, we became friends. And it was a little while later, it was a few years later, you know, we were just friends for a while. But the itch was still there. And I'll tell you what the itch was. In the Great American Songbook, standards way of presenting a song, people will know this without necessarily knowing the form once I say it. The singer sings 32 bars. Then the instruments come in and they play, you know, they improvise and there's pause. And then you sing out the story. I felt very boxed in.
Mm-hmm.
As a person who loves words, I wanted a through composed story. I wanted a whole arc of a story, a lifetime, you know, in the matter of 5-6 minutes. So when we were friends with Ishiguro, and just sitting down to lunch, Jim said, "You know, we should write a song for Stacey." And he said, "You know, we really should." And this was just a throwaway comment. It was nothing. We had no plan. We had no intention. 2 weeks later, he sent the lyrics to the Ice Hotel and Breakfast on the Morning Tram. He sent them by mail, which is really fun. I like this part of the story because he didn't email them. They landed on my
mail letter.
A mailed letter.
Handwritten.
Typed.
Okay.
But still through my through my mailbox.
Still.
And what makes it so powerful is that I was standing on my doorstep, picked up the mail. There's an envelope.
You still checked? You still checked in your mailbox? Yeah. Yeah.
And there was this letter. And I opened it up. And I'm reading in my hands this lyric that was written for me by a man who's one of the world's great writers, who understands me, because he was really inside my music. He really got it. He really got me. I mean, this is the thing about having a novelist like Ishiguro write for you, because he gets inside the human condition. You know, he doesn't just look superficially. And so I felt so understood by him. And
you never worked together before, and somehow that's the first sound he wrote for you, and then you felt the connection. Just thinking, you know, when you're telling me your story, it's almost like different cultures working on, you say, you're from America, your husband is from Britain, at the same time you have the French culture roots, and at the same time you have this Japanese, English, and you have, I don't know, it seems all these different cultures meeting each other, and then there is a role, all these different cultures, maybe also connected back to the fact that you studied comparative literature. You put everything together. How important are these multicultural influences on you, on your career?
It's the key. It's the whole key. And I love this part of it because I don't get on stage because I want to say, ta-da, this is great, this is a great song, I'm a great singer. It's not that. The part about my role as a singer that I find the most beautiful, truly, is the humanity, is the fact that I'm able to tell these stories and connect with all these people around the world, and we share in this human connection, in the human condition. And I think that because of all these different influences from so many different cultures.
Especially true for you, maybe, because you speak all these different languages, five of them?
Yeah.
You speak five different languages, and it's almost like you can travel freely anywhere in the world.
But there's a frustrating part too, because I was a language student and I speak a few languages, and there are languages that I don't speak, like your language and all these languages around the world. You know, I feel locked in. It's really frustrating. If I could do one thing, if life were just infinite, I would just be a never-ending language student. It's really frustrating not to be able to connect with people. And yet, there's a good side. And the good side is this, you know, I grew up listening to a lot of different music from different cultures where I didn't understand the music, the words. For example, I speak Portuguese now, but early on I didn't, and I was listening to João Gilberto, and I felt like I got it on an abstract level. It's kind of like listening to classical music. It's on an abstract level. You don't need words to get it. I grew up on Satyajit Ray movies, right? And I loved the movie music, the songs that they would sing and the incidental music. There were lots of songs. There was the Ravi Shankar side. There was also all of these stories being told, and I didn't get them. But I felt I was finding my own interpretation of them, because that person was telling me a story, opening their soul. So there's a benefit to not being able to understand the words sometimes and to enjoy the music on another level. So there's that side. But yeah, I feel very much part of the world, and that's really important to me. I travel around, I've been in over 50 countries, maybe 55 countries, and we don't live the same daily life. You know, I'll be in Finland or here or anywhere.
That's so exciting.
It is.
Having learned to speak Portuguese, Stacey Kent paid a series of visits to Brazil, where she met many of her musical heroes, including Marcos Valle, Edu Lobo, and Roberto Menescal. Under their influence, bossa nova became an essential part of her international repertoire. She has recorded with both Valle and Menescal, being invited to record with the former on his album O Vivo to celebrate his 50 years in music. Kent revels in the soft, intimate approach of bossa nova, finding that the more softly she sings, the more feeling she can convey.
No barquinho, coração, deslizando na canção, tudo isso foi paz, tudo isso traz.
You mentioned the story with Mr. Roberto, Brazilian music, and you wanted to learn the language because you wanted to understand their bossa nova, their Brazilian music, better to a different stage.
Yes, but even more than that, you know, it's slightly nuanced, but when I was in college I wanted to study Portuguese, and not for the music. They have great poets. You know, there's so much great poetry, and it's all translated. And one of the things that I learned from speaking other languages and studying other languages is that to be inside the poetry, because poetry is something, it's something you feel, it's all over you.
It's still about literature.
It is.
Deep in your heart.
I wanted to study Portuguese in college, and they didn't offer it yet. Portuguese was not a very popular language in academia when I was a college student, which is weird because it's maybe the sixth largest spoken language in the world, and yet you could find French and Spanish and Italian and German. Chinese, Japanese, Russian, more often than Portuguese. Now it's popular, but in those days it wasn't. So I wanted to study it, and it wasn't there.
I mean, language is always like a new window that opens up your horizon to a whole new world. I mean, not to mention Portuguese. Not that many people would be able to speak the language. But if you come back to your music career, it's almost, I don't know if it's been planned by yourself or it just so happens, that I've noticed that there seems to be different phases or different stages of music career. You started interpreting other people's stories, and then you started to have your own sounds, you know, written for you. And then you try to include sounds written by people maybe in different languages from different cultural backgrounds. And you go to Brazil to work with a Brazilian musician. It seems these are all different stages of your music career. I don't know if this is even planned or it just so happened.
No, it's not planned. I like this part of the story. I'm really glad you asked this because it's a path, it's a journey. And you're right, there are periods where things really shifted. Not like a stark shift, like one day I was driving on this side of the road and next day I was driving on that side of the road. They're eventual, you know, they happen slowly, like the itch that I was telling you about. So I sang the Great American Songbook. I felt boxed in. I wanted a through composed story, like I said, and so I started to sing the Ishiguro Tomlinson songs. And Jim, they're a great partnership. They really write beautiful songs together because they really get each other. So we're a great trio together because there's great dialogue. But so I'd say 2007 was a big change for me because that's when I released Breakfast on the Morning Tram. What's exciting about that for me is, you know, I don't think about my career in terms of success. That was never, sure, I have success, and that's great. Because it allows me to travel around the world and perform, and, you know, there's ease with that. But I never thought in those terms, but I was really excited that people recognized this change because you kind of... There's a certain worry, and there were people who said, where are the standards? We want the standards. But you have to know, as the artist out there, you can't work to please other people. You have to build what you've got to build from your heart, and you will take some people with you, and you will lose other people, and that's all okay.
So that's what was driving you for all those changes.
I needed those through composed stories, and what was so important about those stories, and again, just to connect everything to everything, they were that fuel that I talked about from my grandpa and all of that sadness that I grew up with, but because there was a lot of sadness in the house, you know. And the stories that Ishiguro wrote me, and this is the key to the start, I said, you know, your work is so sad, but I interpret them as hopeful, because I am a very optimistic person. So I said, you can give me all that sadness, but you gotta give me a little window of hope. And he said, okay, I got it. You know, I'm gonna do these really sad stories, and I'm just gonna give you this little window of hope, just that sliver. And we still laugh about that, you know, even all these years later. So that was the key to the change in the stories and the change in the music. And Jim would write these songs, the compositions, where the music always had this feeling of moving forward. So literally, metaphorically, you were moving forward in your life, which is what we do. So that was a big change, and I did it for me. And if people liked it, great. And if they didn't, that was fine too.
Because you're trying. Those are your efforts.
Experimenting. Yeah. So there have been changes along the way as I grow. What's nice about being a musician, and what's lucky about being a musician, as opposed to, you know, had I been a ballet dancer. Because I liked ballet, you know, as a little kid. I don't have an end to my career. I work on my voice a lot. My voice is getting better. I'm growing as a musician. And I will continue to do that until the end, I hope. So you're lucky because this is all muscle. You know, you've got hundreds of muscles in here. But you work on your muscles and you practice and you train. In fact, I have my straw on me.
That's for practice. I thought you were drinking something.
Here's my straw. This is really important to me. I'll show you. Yeah. It's got a little tiny aperture, and I do this sort of thing. I learned this from a vocal pathologist called Ingo Tietze, and he invented this. It's a whole long story. It's too long a story, but he's a genius. He's a master, and he helped me so much because when you're working through the straw, you're using so much muscle here. You're not putting as much strain here. You're stretching, and I'm pressing your vocal cords. So when I'm doing things like right now, first of all, I do it all the time anyway, just to warm up. I warm up vocally as well. But if you're tired and I'm on a plane and I need to warm up because I'm going to get off the plane and boom, you got to go, I can do warm-ups quite quietly, and I can take the strain off if you're inflamed. So it's really important to me to continue to practice my voice and grow as a singer. And that's going to go on forever.
Stacey Kent's 2017 release, I Know I Dream, the orchestral sessions, won Album of the Year and the Vocal category at the Jazz Japan Awards. In I Know I Dream, her vocals receive warm support from a sizable 60-strong orchestra. In a series of memorable tracks, she guides the listener through feelings of love, moments of nostalgic reflection, and expressions of joy.
This time, it's over. There's no more to say. You're not coming.
So you love what you're doing, and at the same time you really work very hard on this. So what about this new album, the latest one, the one released in 2017, I Know I Dream?
Yeah.
Then that's when you worked with an orchestra.
Yeah.
That could be intimidating to work with an orchestra because there's so many people and they could be so loud. And
it was intimidating.
It was.
yeah, I'm not going to kid you. It was daunting. But from the second I walked in the room, they're all there. There are 50 of them there in this gorgeous studio. There was so much love and so much excitement. You know, the musicians from the orchestra were coming up to me and saying, two or three of them came together from the violin section and they said, "We love the song Maiso Mavis," which is another song that Jim wrote with a poet from Portugal, Antonio Ladeira. But it's in Portuguese, and they said, "What does it mean?" Because they loved the sound of the song, and they wanted to know what the words meant. And that was such an excitement for me. That was so exhilarating. So there was so much love and connection with these mostly classical musicians who wanted to come on this journey with us. So whatever was daunting was just gone, and we just did it. What's daunting also is that you have to remember to kind of calm yourself, not over-sing, because there are a lot of them. And I like to sing quite quietly. I don't sing as well when I'm singing over-singing. You know, the tone goes. But you remember that you've got your microphone, and there's, great engineers in there controlling it. So you don't have to over-sing. But you have to sort of take a step back and remind yourself, not to react just to the amount of numbers. And now I go on stage, because we've been touring I Know I Dream around the world. We haven't done the show here, but we've been doing it in different countries with orchestras around the world. We were just in Poland this last week with one there, one in Canada right before that. Now, you get it. You can stand in your place and feel quite calm and centered. But it was imperative that I remind myself to not react too quickly and to just take a deep breath, hear it, know that the sound is being controlled, and I could just do my thing. I learned that from the Brazilians, too. I want to add that João Gilberto and Tom Jobim and Edu Lobo are people who have that very natural, intimate way of singing as well. And they often sing with orchestras, and I learned so much from them because they're still them, like when they're alone with their guitar. They just have a lot of people behind them, but they don't change what they do, and I think that was very helpful to me.
So you're a singer, but you see yourself also as an interpreter.
Yes.
Of the stories.
Yes.
Yours or others.
Yes. They become my stories. That's what's fun. You know how everybody has this experience? You know how when you go to a movie and it's meant so much to you, or you read a book and it's meant so much to you, you almost put yourself in it. It's abstract, but you do. You find yourself kind of feeling it. That's how I feel as an interpreter.
In that moment.
Yeah.
Looking forward to hearing more your stories.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great to talk to you.